Hi, everyone. I'm really excited today to continue our partnership with Carbon Health, where we bring your questions that you have from the community to different specialists so they can be answered and have those answers directly in the palm of your hand. And today, I'm really happy to be joined with Dr. Sarah Borish, who is a clinical psychologist and the director of mental health at Carbon Health, where we'll be discussing a really important topic on mental health. And I wanna give Dr. Borish a chance to just give an overview of how does somebody go about setting up an appointment to start checking on their own mental health?
Yeah, that's such a great question, and it can be really daunting to initiate this process. So a couple of different places you can start. If you're not sure, the best place to start can be just your primary care provider. In many cases, your primary care provider is the most likely person to prescribe an antidepressant to begin with. So it's a great place to start. They may also have some good referral sources potentially in your insurance network. So when in doubt, start with your primary care provider. But there are other places you can also look. So just a simple search on the website, something like Psychology Today has a great list of therapists in your area. And it's usually pretty up to date as to whether someone is accepting patients or not. It can be really frustrating to call a lot of providers and then have them just say like, no, I'm not accepting. So that's a great place to start. You can also try reaching out to your insurance company for a list of providers. And when in doubt, there's a ton of great online mental health providers today that really are increasing accessibility across the country and even across the globe, which is really great.
So what could somebody actually expect from their first visit?
Yeah, so the first visit is what we generally call an intake. And in an intake, your provider is going to spend the whole session trying to understand what brought you in that day. They're going to get a really thorough understanding of your symptoms and how they're affecting your day-to-day life, but also some of your background, right? Like your family history, your medical history, and any other important information that can contribute to your whole clinical picture. And from there, you and your provider are going to work together to figure out what the goals for treatment might be and how best to start working toward those goals.
I think that leads great into a question that one of our audience members had is, how does mental health overall play into your full-on health picture?
Yeah, so it's such a good question. You know, I think we're increasingly aware as a society, right, that there's this clear overlap between our mental and physical health. When we feel good in one way, we generally feel better in the other, and vice versa. So, you know, a couple of like key things that I like to think about in kind of assessing the relationship between mental health and physical health are things like your overall sleep health, right? So we need sleep to feel good physically, and it turns out sleep is a really big factor in your overall mental health. Same is true for kind of healthy eating and that kind of thing, right? So these are factors that are actually part of the diagnostic criteria for many mental health disorders, are kind of well understood to contribute to your overall physical health. So I like to think of it and kind of what are the key symptom buckets that overlap.
And as you know, a lot of my platform is based on breaking down that complex science. So we had a ton of questions that came in for individuals who were asking about how do SSRIs work. And I think a lot of them had heard of SSRIs for the treatment of depression or other mental health illnesses. So could you just give a description for the audience of how those SSRIs work and why they work?
That's a great question. So SSRIs are a class of medications. This stands for Selective Serotonin Reuptake Inhibitors. And there are similar medications like SNRIs. And all of these medications are based on a hypothesis called monoamine hypothesis for depression, which basically states that the basis of depression is lower levels of serotonin, norepinephrine, and dopamine in the central nervous system. So a medication like an SSRI or an SNRI, it works by increasing the amount of free-floating kind of neurotransmitter in the postsynaptic space. Okay, so in that space between one neuron and the other, these medications work to increase how much serotonin, norepinephrine, or dopamine one might find. I will say that the hypothesis is a little bit under scrutiny today. It's sort of been the belief for many decades that this monoamine hypothesis explains depression. And we're increasingly kind of suspicious of that hypothesis, I would say. That being said, we do still know that for many people, these medications work, and they work quite well. It just doesn't quite fit in as neatly into our understanding as it used to fit into that understanding.
And you brought up neurotransmitters, and I'm just curious, are those also involved in other conditions that are involved in mental health, such as anxiety?
Yeah, that's a great question. So we definitely have neurotransmitter involvement in many of our mental health conditions. I think a great one to think about is anxiety, right? So in anxiety, we're looking specifically at a neurotransmitter called GABA. It's sort of the calming neurotransmitter, right? So higher levels of GABA, we think of kind of feeling calmer and quieter and more at peace. So with anxiety, we would expect to see kind of the opposite of that, right? So not quite enough of GABA. It's not just, right, our neurotransmitters. There's also a hormonal component to this. So I think we talked about the HPA axis in previous conversations, right? Looking at long COVID and the dysregulation of the HPA axis. Something like that also, it turns out, is involved in anxiety, right? When we have higher levels of cortisol and sort of a long-standing exposure to cortisol throughout your body can lead to anxiety.
And one of the things that was really interesting with our long COVID conversation was that cortisol was kind of becoming this potential biomarker as an identifier of long COVID, the actual decrease of cortisol for one individual. And some individuals in the community were also wondering, is there any biomarkers or research that's ongoing for molecules that could be detected for certain mental health conditions?
Yeah, this is such an important area for the future of mental health. So when we look at the way we diagnose mental health conditions right now, it's really a checklist, right? So we're walking through a list of symptoms and we're kind of seeing what someone has and what they don't have. And it can be a little bit subjective. And it also leads to people walking out of their doctor's office with like three or four different diagnoses when probably what's happening is really one underlying syndrome, right? But it just, that's the way our checklist system works right now. So there's a lot of movement toward trying to find some biomarkers. There's a couple of cool spaces here. So one of them is that there's an indication that some of our inflammatory responses, some of our immune hyperactivity could be associated with depression, with anxiety. So there are certain biomarkers that they're looking for in blood tests there. We're also looking at some neuroanatomical changes among people with depression, anxiety, or other related conditions. And so we can look at like functional neuroimaging, like an fMRI, and start to see changes in someone's what we call the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, so kind of up here toward the front. Other changes might be seen in sort of the anterior cingulate, the amygdala, hippocampus. So all of these areas are starting to show some difference among people with depression and anxiety. And then another really cool space in this biomarker world is looking at different gut biomes. So it turns out you've got a nervous system in your digestive tract. That can be a really early warning sign, actually, for depression and anxiety. So very early science there, but cool stuff coming out.
A lot of things involved with this whole conversation.
Yeah, which I think goes back to some of your earlier question about the linking between mental health and physical health. Mm-hmm. Like we often think of mental health as really being kind of stuck up in the brain, and it's the whole body, right? It's affecting all of your different systems. So it makes sense that we would find signs of that throughout the body.
Right. And because of that, is there also some type of genetics that are in play related to our mental health?
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, certainly when I'm meeting with a patient, I'm really trying to understand their genetic history, right? Do they have a family history of any of these conditions? It sort of leads to this idea of like a genetic vulnerability, right? So it's not that just because your mom has depression, you're going to have depression, but it increases potentially your level of vulnerability. We're not just looking at genetics though, of course, right? We're also thinking about genetics in the context of psychosocial stressors and coping strategies that you might have. So it's genetic, but it's genetic with a lot of other contextual factors at play.
And I want to kind of transition the conversation to, as you mentioned, some of these social factors. We had some questions coming in as right now there's some natural disasters that have been ongoing in the US, but also around the world. And some community members wondered, how does that play into maybe triggering some mental health conditions or bringing back some mental health conditions that somebody may be suffering from?
Yeah, so in the immediate response to some kind of trauma, a natural disaster, your body goes into the fight or flight mode, right? Which again, comes back to this HPA axis that keeps coming up in conversations, right? So your body body responds to stress by going into fight or flight, which is exactly what it's supposed to do. And it only really becomes a problem when it's chronic, when it doesn't quite reset back to that baseline. And on the one hand, when you're constantly exposed to trauma, like you look at some of the things happening around the globe, global conflict, you never really get the chance to reset, so it stays up, right? And then there are other times where perhaps it's a hurricane or there's a natural disaster and your body reacts, and then it just doesn't quite reset itself back to baseline in the aftermath. And that's where we start looking at sort of clinical syndromes. And so in the immediate aftermath of a trauma, we might see someone having an acute stress reaction, which looks like, you know, intrusive memories, avoiding things that are triggering, negative emotions, problems experiencing positive emotions. And this can rise to a clinical level, but we would expect almost anyone in the aftermath of a trauma to have some negative symptoms, right? If those don't reset over the course of about a month, that's when we start looking at something like PTSD or post-traumatic stress disorder. And that's sort of this more chronic, ongoing response to a trauma. And I like, it's basically, it's fight or flight that your body just never quite snaps out of. You kind of stay in that highly elevated state long past the point where your body was designed to be in that elevated state, and hopefully long past the point where you're actually in that acute traumatic situation. Not always though.
Is this something that can be involved with the past 3 years, as we've seen with the COVID-19 pandemic as well?
Yeah, absolutely. I think for so many of us, that was a deeply traumatic experience going through the pandemic, especially anyone on the front lines or anyone who watched a loved one sick. It would be very difficult to walk away without experiencing some elements of this traumatic reaction. When it persists to a point where you don't, or you're struggling to experience more positive emotions, where you're having intrusive flashbacks and you're avoiding situations that might remind you of parts of these trauma, that's where we really want to start intervening clinically. But some level of kind of trauma response to COVID, I think, is almost universal right now.
And what has the pandemic done to mental health services overall, both in a positive way, but also maybe in a not so positive way?
Yeah, well, let's start with the not so positive, right? Which is, the rates of mental health conditions globally have spiked up pretty significantly since the pandemic. It's really become quite common, much more common than we've seen in the past. And what that means is that there are fewer providers, right, available, and more people in need of clinicians, mental health care. And so that has been a real challenge. And it's something that as a field, but also as a country and as a global community, we're gonna have to figure out how best to address that. On the other hand, I will say, both personally and like anecdotally, but also there's some data that back this up, the general understanding of the importance of mental health, a recognition that mental health matters as much as physical health, that has really become, I think, more ingrained in our culture in a way that I hadn't seen before the pandemic. People are comfortable talking about mental health in a way that most people or many people were not before the pandemic. It's become a thing that we talk about, we can acknowledge. And so even though there's a shortage of providers and many more people in need of services, we're talking about the fact that that need exists, which is really a great step in the right direction, I would say.
I think that's really great to hear that we do have some positives that have been coming out of this. And that kind of brings us into our last question from our audience. We mentioned this before, talking about the biological aspects of mental health, but also some of the societal aspects of mental health. Where do you see those two merging on someone coming into their journey on, you know, exploring their own mental health?
Yeah, so we think of mental health, and I use what I would call the biopsychosocial framework, which is exactly what it sounds like, right? So we all have our underlying biological vulnerabilities or strengths, right? And then we think of that in the context of our psychological strengths and weaknesses, right? Where have we built skills and resilience over the years? Where have we not done so, right? So we have these psychological vulnerabilities as well. And then we put all of that in the social context, mind. So we have this social context of a global pandemic that has dramatically changed the way we live our lives for a time. And then each person is bringing their own biological and psychological qualities into that equation. And so for some people, that winds up meaning severe anxiety and a need for intervention. For other people, it's a lower level of stress, most likely increased over baseline, but not quite to a clinical threshold. And so those are the ways we think about the whole picture, right? It's not just biological. It's not just social. It's the whole package.
Well, I think that this has just been such a fantastic conversation, and it's going to really benefit a lot of individuals in the community who had reached out and asked their questions. So I want to thank Dr. Borish so much for giving us her time, and also give an opportunity for you to share with the community where they might be able to find you, whether that's on LinkedIn or maybe on some social networks, so they can follow along with new research that may be coming out that you're sharing, or just some thoughts that you have on the mental health field.
That's great. So you can find me on LinkedIn, it's just Sarah Borish, or Instagram, where I'm S, my first initial and last name Borish, and that's my handle there.
Perfect. Well, thank you so much. And I think that this was a great way to begin the conversation of mental health, and we'll only keep it going. This is not a topic that is closed. As Sarah mentioned, we have so many new areas of research that are coming out, and constantly things are being updated, that we'd love to hear more questions from the audience, and you know, we can have another conversation in a few months.
That sounds great. Keep the questions coming.
Thank you. Everybody have a great day. Bye.